Hello and welcome to IT Chronicles 10 in Tech. We're here at Knowledge 17. My name is Carlos Casanova and we're here with Kirstie Magowan.
Hi, Carlos.
And Susan Reed from
Hello.
Space Telescope.
Thank you.
That's the Hubble guys, right?
Yes, it is.
That's awesome, awesome. So Susan, you know, we met about a year or so ago and I know we were talking about some great things. One of those being problems in lots of them. I know you spend a lot of time in that space, and there's a lot of vendors out there that help out in space, like Captain Trago and a bunch of other companies and stuff. But I mean, you've had a lot of experience dealing with problem management and root cause analysis. Tell us a little bit about some of that stuff that that you've been working in there.
Well, I think that what we have faced working at Space Telescope is while we're doing great things out in space, we're not quite doing the same thing behind the scenes. We've been a little slow to get with technology. So I think part of our challenge has always been to take incident management and identify that we actually have problems in our environment and try to fix those problems. We're still patching things when we actually need to identify that we have a problem and come up with a systematic way to get people to get to the root cause so that we can get them fixed quickly.
So that's kind of interesting. I kind of laugh, coming from an actual engineering background. And I've been into different companies. It that always shocks me. So the front end, you can't deal with, little incidents on the Hubble telescope. That is catastrophe. And they probably have some of the deepest root cause analysis efforts that they probably, could imagine. But
they
yet
do.
None of that translates to the front. And I just, it's amazing, and it's not unique. I've seen that in other places. How does that not cross the border?
Well, I think that probably how we were structured as an IT organization for IT, and then the engineers sit outside of IT. So I think that there's a challenge across when you have separate budgets and separate silos, and there's no standards. And I think our organization struggled a little bit with, we're different because no one else does what we do, so we're special. So we tend to not want to implement best practices or standards or industry standards. So it's been a real challenge to get people to look at things and say, just because we're different doesn't mean we can't implement these best practices and do the things that we know we need to do to fix the root cause, to come up with, here are the problems that we're having, here's what we need to do to resolve them. But it's teaching people that you have, there is a systematic approach to things. There is a way that you can look at these things and get to the bottom root cause. And if you follow this methodology, each time we'll save time, we'll resolve things quicker, which ultimately saves money, energy, we gain efficiencies.
Mm-hmm. And the principles are no different. That's the thing that, like I said, amazes me, is the principles are still no different. Exactly the same principles that they have if something blips, on the telescope. They're gonna go through the investigation and try and find out, it blips all the time, it blips here and there. Same exact principles to do that.
Yeah, there is no difference between the way you work that out and the way you work out what's wrong with your stove at home. I mean, you can use the same principles to fix that as you can to find out what's going on.
I find that I use ITIL methodology at home. For every project we do, I'm looking at, how are we going to do this? What's the best way to do it? What has everyone else done? What is the best practice, no matter what we do? So I know that this falls into IT, but I look at the same thing. If you keep having the same problem at home, you're gonna say at some point, I think something's broke here, and if we fix this, we'll stop having these incidents occur.
Yeah, right. And you use the same methodology for doing it. You use the same, what's different about this? Why?
Yes.
What changed?
Yeah, what changed?
So that's interesting. So the predictive side of it, I guess, is what always, I don't want to say fascinating, but always intrigued me about the problem management space. Is not just, there's 20 of them that came in, but looking at that, the predictive side where you're looking at the patterns and trends, we've seen this before. Can we start getting ahead of this? Because we know what the end result is if it goes that long. How far along are you in that sort of, not just the predictive side, but the whole problem management space?
Well, I think what's been funny to me is why people are so afraid to declare a problem. So I've had a real challenge getting folks in our IT environment to say, I have a problem, because they feel like that's bad. Like they need to hide that and they're gonna get in trouble or something's gonna happen. So I think we've looked at how can we change their experience so that we create a new belief for them that if you have a problem, if you identify that there's a problem in the environment, you get help, you get extra resources, right. you get more attention, more focus. And then when you resolve a problem in the environment that's going to drive down our incidents, that you get rewarded for that. So we're looking at how can we give them a different experience to give them a different belief so we drive different actions. And I think that's the key to making sure that they understand it's not bad to say that there's a problem in the environment. It doesn't mean that someone's done something wrong. Technology breaks.
Right. Then, yeah.
So it's getting people to believe that saying that we have a problem and then having a systematic way to attack that problem, to come up with how you fix it, how you resolve it, is the key.
Yeah, right. So identifying a problem becomes a positive.
Yes, yes, definitely. I think that's key for IT folks, because I think a lot of times they just don't see the value because it's been their experience in the past. If I say that I have a problem, then I'm going to be in trouble. Everybody's going to be looking at me like it's my fault, and that's not the case.
Right. Yeah. Just because you identified it doesn't mean you caused it.
Right.
Yeah, and even if you caused it, I mean, sometimes things happen. And problems are not, I mean, they're typically bigger than that, right? They're bigger than one person. They're bigger than, by definition, it's a lot of things that kind of came together to find that root cause. So working upstream, how do you get engaged with, you know, the incident side and stuff to get more? Because if the information is not there for you, you know, whether it's your CMDB or whatever, doing the root cause analysis is even trickier. So you've got people that are hesitant to declare it, and then you get there and you find out that your data is there, not there.
Well, I think for us, I know that it's been really crucial to come up with your process. Before we looked at tools, we were trying to identify, well, what's our process? How are we going to go about doing this? And there are some great methodologies out there, some great vendors to work with, and some great tools to work with. But we had to identify how we were going to go about it. And then we could look at, okay, now what tools, what can we put in place to help automate it, to make it go faster, get training for our folks? I think training is key.
Right.
For any of our teams, and it's funny, I have a brother-in-law who's an engineer, and when I told him about that we were going to do some training in problem management, he's like, oh, I'm the one that'll fix it when you guys can't figure it out. And I'm like, no, that's not what it is.
No.
So it's like getting, sometimes it's the group of people that you're working with, whether they're very, very technical or engineers, changing that mindset to identify that common way to get to the root cause of a problem.
Right, right. Yeah. And that is the thing. But you know, we've promoted those people a lot of times, right?
Yes.
You know, we've rewarded them for being the superhero and stuff. We do need. And I think you did a presentation on that
I've
a
done
year
a couple
or two
of presentations
on superheroes and stuff.
Yeah.
And I think that's part of the problem. We've incented the behavior that we really don't want there, so. Yeah.
And it's very hard to change that.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, thank you so much, Susan, for coming. Really enjoyed it.
Thank you,
Kirstie. Thank you.
Lovely to meet you. Thanks, Susan.